Good morning and a very warm welcome to you all on this special service to mark the 50th anniversary of the inaugural service of Grahamston United Church. I'd like now to invite Kath Craig to cut the cake, wherever it is. Kath is probably one of our longest serving members. Wait till she comes back. Since our 50th anniversary is a jubilee, to open our service, I thought I'd take my call to worship from some words from the book of Leviticus, chapter 25. To remind us of God's command for the year of Jubilee. You shall count off second weeks of years, 7 times 7 years, so that the period of 7 weeks of years gives 49 years. And you shall hallow the 50th year. You shall return every one of you to your property and every one of you to your family. It shall be a Jubilee for you. As it is a Jubilee, it shall be holy to you. Now let's worship God in our opening hymn, All People That on Earth Do Dwell.
Let us pray. Loving, gracious God, we come before you as we mark this milestone in the life of this church. We give you thanks for your guidance, your prodding and your leading over these past 50 years, and indeed in our different traditions in times before that. We give you thanks for all we have accomplished in your name, but we also know that sometimes we have missed the mark. Forgive us those failings. We thank you for all those with whom we have had contact over the lifetime of this congregation, whether it was for joyous reasons or sad ones, or for whatever reason they found themselves here in this building or in touch with us in other ways and places. As we, through that contact, however brief, have shared something of your love for all people. We thank you for the witness of your people in this place, down the years, and all it has contained. At this time of celebration, we cannot stand only looking backwards, but must also look forward. And so we thank you for all that is past, but ask also that you will walk with us into the future, your future in and for the life of this church. May we who this day celebrate this 50th anniversary remember how you support, guide, encourage, challenge and disturb us. Help us to walk with you, knowing that we are loved, valued, and forgiven by you. Help us to go forward in hope and joy. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen.
Can I just say what a privilege it is for Yvonne and I to be back amongst you on such an occasion as this and celebrate the gospel together. After many years of memories. Hear the word of God just as it is contained in Psalm 122, I rejoiced when they said to me, "Let us go to the house of the Lord." Now we stand within your gates, O Jerusalem. Jerusalem, that is built to be a city where people come together in unity, to which the tribes resort, the tribes of the Lord, to give thanks to the Lord himself, the bounden duty of Israel. For in her are set the thrones of justice, the thrones of the house of David. Pray for the peace of Jerusalem. May those who love you prosper. Peace be within your ramparts and prosperity in your palaces. For the sake of these, my brothers and my friends, I will say, peace be within you. For the sake of the house of the Lord our God, I will pray for your good. And in the book of Isaiah, chapter 61, the Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me. He has sent me to bring good news to the humble, to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to captives and release to those in prison, to proclaim a year of the Lord's favor and the day of the vengeance of our God, to comfort all who mourn, to give them garlands instead of ashes, oil of gladness instead of mourners' tears, a garment of splendor for the heavy heart. They shall be called trees of righteousness, planted by the Lord for his glory. And now let us sing the hymn. Praise to the Lord, the Almighty, the King of creation.
Letter to the Ephesians, chapter 4, beginning to read at verse 1. I entreat you then, I, a prisoner for the Lord's sake, as God has called you, live up to your calling. Be humble always and gentle, and patient too. Be forbearing with one another and charitable. Spare no effort to make fast with bonds of peace the unity which the Spirit gives. There is one body and one spirit, as there is also one hope held out in God's call to you, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all. But each of us has been given his gift, his due portion of Christ's bounty. Therefore, Scripture says, he ascended into the heights with captives in his train. He gave gifts to men. Now the word ascended implies that he also descended to the lowest level, down to the very earth. He who descended is no other than he who ascended far above all heavens so that he might fill the universe. And these were his gifts, some to be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors and teachers, to equip God's people for work in his service, to the building up of the body of Christ. So shall we all at last attain to the unity inherent in our faith and our knowledge of the Son of God, to mature manhood measured by nothing less than the full stature of Christ. We are no longer to be children, tossed by the waves and whirled about by every fresh gust of teaching, dupes of crafty rogues and their deceitful schemes. No, let us speak the truth in love. So shall we fully grow up into Christ. He is the head, and on him the whole body depends. Bonded and knit together by every constituent joint, the whole frame grows through the due activity of each part and builds itself up in love. Grahamston United Church Choir will now sing "Bind Us Together."
The Gospel reading is taken from John chapter 17, verses 19 through 23. And for their sakes I sanctify myself, so that they also may be sanctified in truth. I ask not only on behalf of these, but also on behalf of those who will believe in me through their word, that they may all be one. As you, Father, are in me, and I am in you, may they also be in us, so that the world may believe that you have sent me. The glory that you have given me, I have given them, so that they may be one as we are one. I in them, and you in me, that they may become completely one, so the world may know that you have sent me and have loved them, even as you have loved me. The Gospel of Christ. We now sing the hymn, "Guide Me, O Thou Great Jehovah."
Thank you. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be pleasing in your sight, O Lord, our rock and redeemer. Amen. It is very much a pleasure to join you all this morning, both here and I understand online, as you mark 50 years to the day, the union not just of four congregations, which itself would be quite a remarkable achievement, but four congregations comprising three denominations: Trinity Congregational Church, James Street Methodist Church, Grahams Road Church of Scotland, and Grahamston Parish Church, and more recently, to be joined by St. James Parish Church. And so on such an occasion, it is a privilege to bring you the warm greetings and congratulations on behalf of the General Assembly of the Church of Scotland. And I'm also delighted to be sharing in worship this morning in person with Paul Whittle and Mark Slaney, whom I'm more used to seeing on screen at meetings of the Scottish Church Leaders Forum. To date, when I have been asked to share in a congregation's anniversary service, it has been to celebrate an event sometime in the 19th century. Today's foundation event is, of course, much closer to home. Those of us of a certain age will have ready memories of 1972. Indeed, 50 years ago today, people would have heard the news that the liner Queen Elizabeth, launched in Clyde Bank in 1938, was ablaze in Hong Kong Harbour. Personally, 1972 was a significant year, as it was when I left home to go to university, and at Cambridge where I discovered the rich experience of ecumenism. The following year, I was confirmed in the United Reformed Church in Cambridge, the URC in England itself having only been formed the previous year in 1972. And just so I can say I'm covering all bases, when I went to Edinburgh in 1975 to study Scots law, I regularly worshipped in the Church of Scotland, but indulged my non-conformist tendencies by joining the University Methodist Society. Reading a newspaper article from 50 years ago, reporting on a press briefing given ahead of the service of union by the three ministers, the Reverends Maxwell Craig, Tom Fouinette, and William Downey, I could readily identify with their description of experience of sharing in worship with other denominations, an experience which drew the congregations here in Grahamston together. Mr. Craig referred to the cooperation practiced over many years, and they emphasized that the decision of union was a decision by the congregations and not simply a plan of the ministers. Mr. Fouinette said that the experiment would last for 2 years, during which there would be reviews. And here we are 50 years later. And without being complacent, I think we can say the experiment has worked. Although blessed by the service of distinguished and accomplished ministers and church leaders, I'm sure much of that success is attributable to the commitment of the membership. But I was particularly struck by a comment from Mr. Downey, who acknowledged serious divisions in the Reformed Church in the past, but said, during the past 4 years, it has been proved that there are no doctrinal differences between us. Sadly, the history of the Church in Scotland, let alone in the wider world, means that it has not always been possible to say that. The passage we've just heard read from John's Gospel comes at the end of Jesus' farewell discourse with his disciples. And at the very beginning of that discourse, at the start of the Last Supper engagement, John describes how Jesus washed the feet of his disciples and commanded them, "I, your Lord and teacher, have just washed your feet. You then should wash one another's feet. I've set an example for you, so you will do just what I have done for you." I was much taken by an observation on that passage that over the centuries, the Church had taken this command to be as central to its liturgy as the command to share bread and wine. How different history might have been. At least, that was until I read a reflection on the very same thought by the Reverend Mark Oakley, now Dean of St. John's College, Cambridge. He wrote, Just imagine what we would have made of it. We would have had arguments over which foot should be washed first, the right or the left. There would be a church of the left footers and a communion of the right footers. We would have had synods on whether the water should be hot or cold. We'd be fighting over whether women could wash feet, whether gay people could have their feet washed, and we'd be wondering how to behave towards those who had never had a foot washed. Now, there's something of a parody, but deep down, we know just how much it can ring true of centuries of dispute and schisms within the body of Christ. And so Mark Oakley concludes, we have a clever knack for concentrating on what doesn't matter to hide what does. So what does matter? As we celebrate this united congregation, I should like to reflect on the importance and the nature of unity, on the crucial relevance of community, and thirdly, that there can be no limits to our community. May I suggest that much of the unity we cherish and aspire to will flow from a focus on Jesus and love. In the passage from chapter 17 of John's Gospel, Jesus is actually praying rather than exhorting. And his prayer is for those who will believe in me through their, that is, through the disciples' word, that they may all be one. Now just think about that for a moment. Jesus is praying for those of us down through time who believe in him through the words initially taught by his disciples. He is praying for us, for you and for me. And his prayer is that we may all be one. And he goes on to pray that the world will come to know him, who he is, and the unique nature of his love by the unity of the love that his followers show for each other. And that surely was the message which Paul was conveying to the church in Ephesus when he begged them to lead a life worthy of the calling to which you have been called, with all humility and gentleness, with patience, bearing one another in love. So we see here what the key features of the unity are to which we aspire. Humility, not being holier than thou, or claiming to be superior to other members of the one body of the church. Gentleness with patience, seeking to encourage and to build up, rather than to act in a competitive or a combative fashion. And above all, showing love one for another. And whilst we might sagely nod in agreement, how different would the history of the church been down through the centuries? These had in fact been the watchwords of those who seek to follow Jesus. And Paul goes on to make the point that within the unity, there will be diversity. Not only does he describe the different God-given gifts to be used for the building up of the body of Christ, but when Paul talks about bearing with one another, there is an expectation that people will be different. We shouldn't confuse difference with division. Unity is not uniformity. And as I'm sure has been the experience here in Grahamston, learning from our different traditions can enrich our experience of worship and bring to us fresh insights into our faith. The covenant, which has been part of the Methodist tradition since its institution by John Wesley in the mid-18th century, and which Mark Slaney will lead us later in his service, is not only of fundamental importance in the Methodist Church, it has surely been a much valued contribution to the liturgy of the Church as a whole. I recall as a student joining friends in the Methodist Society for a covenant service when we returned at the start of the calendar year. It was both a solemn and a powerful occasion. And reading over the covenant prayer ahead of today's service, the words, "You are mine and I am yours," we are reminded that our lives don't depend on our own strength, but on God's. And although the covenant prayer is, in an important sense, an individual's commitment in response to all that God has done for us, the service is surely very much one of the whole faith community. community, then I believe is another vital feature of unity. For I cannot read today's passages from John's Gospel or the letter to the Ephesians without thinking that although we seek an individual relationship with God, there is fulfillment in being part of a community of faith. In recent days, we have remembered the extraordinary life of witness and service of Archbishop Desmond Tutu. It was through reading his book, God is Not a Christian, that I was introduced to that wonderful African concept of Ubuntu. No doubt it is capable of lengthy explanation, but Desmond Tutu's brief summation of Ubuntu speaks volumes to me. I am because we are. I am because we are. It is through building positive and loving relationships with others, including within our church community, that we find our own individuality enhanced. And by a similar token, the life of our respective churches can be enriched by our relationships with each other in building up communities of faith. So thirdly, the purpose of unity and sense of community must be dynamic and not static. Not only do we seek to grow in love for each other, but our community should be open and not introverted. When Jesus preached what might be described as his inaugural sermon in the synagogue in Nazareth, he used as his text the words from the prophet Isaiah, which we have also read this morning. Luke tells us that the initial response from the congregation was in fact very favorable, but was when, by reference to the stories of Elijah and Elisha bringing relief to foreigners, Jesus challenged his listeners' assumption that they were the sole recipients of God's mercy and favor. And that's when they turned on him. Jesus' clear message was that God's love has no boundaries, and its relevance continues to this day. It is an antidote to those who would try to build walls around their elite interpretation of the gospel message. And it is surely an encouragement to those who, like the pioneers of this united congregation, want to build bridges. Bridges not only between denominations, but bridges out into the community. The Reverend Maxwell Craig at that inaugural press briefing said that this part of Falkirk had been noted as a meeting place. And he continued, if as Christians we can meet together, we are fulfilling the destiny of this community. And as if underlining that vision, a later document describing the progress of the United Church noted that buildings had been extended and improved, were in use morning to night, 7 days a week, and not only for church groups, but also for other groups in the community. For at a time such as now, when the structural challenges of our institutional church life can consume so much time and energy, we must not lose sight of what we can achieve by working together, and not least in taking the good news of the kingdom and the vision which Isaiah foresaw and which Jesus proclaimed out into the community. At the inaugural service 50 years ago, the preacher was the Very Reverend Lord MacLeod of Funery. In his book, One Way Left, George MacLeod graphically spells out that message. He says, I simply argue that the cross must be raised again at the center of the marketplace as well as on the steeple of the church. I am recovering the claim that Jesus was not crucified in a cathedral between two candles, but on a cross between two thieves, on the town garbage heap, at a crossroads so cosmopolitan that they had to write his title in Hebrew and Latin and in Greek, at the kind of place where cynics talk smut and thieves curse and soldiers gamble. Because that is where he died, and that is what he died about. And that is the message which in unity we must surely continue to proclaim. Amen. And the offering will now be received.
We join to sing the hymn, "Come Holy Ghost, Our Hearts Inspire."
So we move through the words of the covenant service with its prayer that we are invited to say together for ourselves. We find ourselves moved to the table. And one of those things which holds us together in unity, we all partake of the one bread. And Christ gives himself to us. And he is in us. And we are in him. And our unity is complete. When we come to the act of the communion, the Holy Communion with the bread and wine, although we meet together and although we are united, we happen to meet during a period of time known as pandemic or COVID coronavirus. And so we actually have to be separate, don't we? We have to be a meter or two apart. You should find that nearby you there's a little hook, and on the hook you should find there's a glass with a bit of bread in it and a glass with some wine in it. And so unfortunately I can't invite you to the table, nor can I send the elements to you where you're at, because we're minimizing contact, understandably and rightly so. But you have bread and wine prepared and ready for you, and the prayers that we shall enter into together will draw us to a time when we'll take that particular bread and wine. What we will make sure we'll do is that we will eat all together and we will drink all together to mark our unity and to celebrate the ecumenical life of this particular part of Christ Church. God made a covenant with the people of Israel, calling them to be a holy nation, chosen to bear witness to his steadfast love by finding delight in the law. The covenant was renewed in Jesus Christ our Lord in his life, work, death, and resurrection. In him, all people may be set free from sin and its power and united in love and obedience. In this covenant, God promises us new life in Christ. For our part, we promise to live no longer for ourselves, but for God. We meet, therefore, as generations have met before us, to renew the covenant which bound them and binds us to God. Let us then seek forgiveness for the sin by which we have denied God's claim upon us. I think if the screen would move forward, that would be really helpful. Thank you. So the bold type of the words we say in prayer together. God of mercy, hear us as we confess our sins. For the sin that's made us slow to learn from Christ, reluctance to follow him, and afraid to bear the cross. Lord, have mercy. Lord, forgive. For the sin that's caused the poverty of our worship, the formality and selfishness of our prayers, our neglect of fellowship and the means of grace, and our hesitating witness for Christ. Lord, have mercy. Lord, forgive. For the sin that's led us to misuse your gifts, evade our responsibilities, and fail to be good stewards of your creation. Lord, have mercy. Lord, forgive. For the sin that's made us unwilling to overcome evil with good, tolerant of injustice, quick to condemn, and selfish in sharing your love with others. Lord, have mercy. Lord, forgive. And in a moment of silent prayer, we make our own confessions before God. Some words from Psalm 51, hopefully on the screen for us to say together. Oh, not that though. I'll continue to lead us in prayer. Have mercy on me, O God, in your constant love, in the fullness of your mercy, blot out my offenses. Wash away all my guilt and cleanse me from my sin. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Give me the joy of your help again, and strengthen me with a willing spirit. If we confess our sins, God is faithful and just, and will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Therefore, to all who truly repent, this is his gracious word. Your sins are forgiven. Amen. Thanks be to God. Sisters and brothers in Christ, let us again accept our place within this covenant which God has made with us and with all who are called to be Christ's disciples. This means that by the help of the Holy Spirit, we accept God's purpose for us and the call to love and serve God in all our life and work. Christ has many services to be done. Some are easy, others are difficult. Some bring honour, others bring reproach. Some are suitable to our natural inclinations and material interests. Others are contrary to both. In some, we may please Christ and please ourselves. In others, we cannot please Christ except by denying ourselves. Yet, the power to do all these things is given to us in Christ, who strengthens us. Therefore, let us make this covenant of God our own. Let us give ourselves to him, trusting in his promises and relying on his grace. Eternal God, in your faithful and enduring love, you call us to share in your gracious covenant in Jesus Christ. In obedience, we hear and accept your commands. In love, we seek to do your perfect will. With joy, we offer ourselves anew to you. If you're willing and able, would you like to stand with me? We are no longer our own, but yours. And we say together, I am no longer my own, but yours. Your will, not mine, be done in all things. Wherever you may place me, in all that I do, and in all that I may endure, when there is work for me, and when there is none, when I am troubled, and when I am at peace. Your will be done when I am valued and when I am disregarded, when I find fulfillment and when it is lacking, when I have all things and when I have nothing. I willingly offer all I have and am to serve you, as and where you choose. Glorious and blessed God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, you are mine, and I am yours. May it be so forever. Let this covenant, now made on earth, be fulfilled in heaven. Amen. Please be seated. And we hold a moment's silent prayer as we allow the weight of that both to fall upon us and to liberate us. As we have entered this covenant not for ourselves alone, but as God's servants and witnesses, let us pray for the church and for the world. Loving God, hear us as we pray for your holy Catholic Church. Make us all one, that the world may believe. Inspire and lead all who govern and hold authority in the nations of the world. Establish justice and peace among all people. Have compassion on all who suffer from any sickness, grief, or trouble. Deliver them from their distress. We praise you for your saints who have entered your eternal glory. Bring us all to share in your heavenly kingdom. Let us continue to pray in silence for our own needs and for those of others. Lord our God, you've helped us by your grace to make these prayers. And you've promised through Christ our Lord that when two or three agree in his name, you will grant what they ask. Answer now your servants' prayers according to their needs. In this world, grant that we may truly know you. And in the world to come, graciously give us eternal life. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. So as we come to the table, we begin by sharing with one another the peace. If you'd like to stand, I remind you that you're not invited to move if you'd like to stay still where you are, but there comes a moment where we stay together and also with you. And whilst we can't turn and shake hands, and I mean, we can bump if we're within reach, but you can, of course, look at one another. The eyes can give away a smile, can't they, even if you're masked. The Lord has made an everlasting covenant of peace with his people. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Do be seated. The table is ready. It's not entirely laden with bread and wine because it's already with you. But all is in place. Our gifts are offered. Bread and wine for our holy communion with God. Our gifts of money, and along with them in the covenant, all that we have and all that we are always for God's purpose in God's world. If we move the slide on one. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. God our Father, fountain of goodness, creator of all that is, you've made us in your own image. You've given us life and reason and love for one another, setting in our hearts a hunger for you. In darkness, you are our light. In adversity and temptation, our strength. You bear patiently with our folly and sin, granting us your law to guide us and your prophets to renew our faith. In the fullness of time, you came to us in love and mercy in Jesus Christ, your living word, full of grace and truth. He lived among us, declaring your forgiveness and revealing your wisdom in works of mercy and in his word of power. For us, he suffered and died upon the cross, by death, destroying death. And you raised him from the dead and exalted him to your right hand on high. Through him, you sent your Holy Spirit to be the life and the light of your people, gathered together in every time and place to glorify your holy name. With them and all the company of heaven, we join in the unending hymn of praise, saying together, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy God, pour out your Spirit, we ask, that these gifts of bread and wine may be for us the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who on the night in which he was betrayed, took bread, gave thanks, and broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this and eat it. This is my body, given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave thanks and gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. And so, Lord, we obey his command with this bread and this cup, by which we recall his death and resurrection, the source of our life and salvation. Grant that we who share in this holy sacrament may be united by your Spirit and grow into perfect love. Bring us, with those who have done your will in every age, into the light of your presence and the joy of your kingdom. Through Christ, with Christ, in Christ, in the power of the Holy Spirit, we worship you in songs of everlasting praise. Blessing and honor and glory and power be yours forever and ever. Amen. The things of God, for God's holy people. Jesus Christ is holy. Jesus Christ is Lord. Glory to God the Father. Jesus said, "I am the bread of life. Those who come to me shall not hunger, and those who believe in me shall never thirst." We take the bread. Body of Christ, broken for us. Amen. We take the cup of wine, the blood of Christ shed for us, keep us in eternal life. Amen. Let us pray. We say together the words on the screen. Faithful God, with these holy gifts, you have strengthened us in Jesus Christ, your Son. Guide us on our way, that with all your faithful people, we may come to share the feast of your eternal kingdom. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
So we continue in prayer. Let us pray. Loving God, as we come before you now, we give you thanks for this day. We give you thanks for all that has brought us to this point. We give you thanks for all who have been part of the life of this congregation, for all the ways in which we have been able to shine as your light in this community. And as we come before you now, we pray that you will bless us as we continue with that task. Help us to remember that we are the living stones with which you build your church. Help us to remain faithful to our calling. By your grace, may our lives be the examples on which those after us may build. And so may all we do be to your praise and your glory. Lord our God, hear our prayer. Hear all our prayers, which we sum up now as we join in the words of the family prayer, saying together,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses.
We forgive our debtors, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. This is where I get to go just slightly off piste, not because I've chosen to, but because I've been instructed to. But just to say, as Lord Wallace has, that it's a great joy for us and for other guests and participants to be here sharing this very special occasion. We can all go back. I remember my early days of ministry when Robert Phillip would have been fairly newly your minister, because it was just the year after you started here, Robert, that I was ordained and inducted in Beath. In North Ayrshire, and that seems a very long time ago. It's not quite back to 72, but across the years, so many things and so many people have been part of the life of this church. And we want to recognize that. We're celebrating the coming together and all that we've been for the past 50 years today. But we also want to mark 50 years of great service as an elder of this church. And Ian Crozier, who I think does not know that I'm going to say this now, but I'm going to ask him to come forward, because we want to mark that today and to celebrate that with him. Ian. It's a great joy for me that I've got a Church of Scotland certificate. I've got the moderator of the General Assembly, who I'm sure, come on up, yes, please. I'm sure will not object to me presenting this. But that's the joy of these ecumenical things. Ian, it is really a great joy for me and a privilege to have the opportunity to recognise your service and to be the one who presents this to you with the grateful thanks of this congregation. And praying God's continuing blessing on you and your service. Well done. I got to do that because I'm told, Ian, that you're of congregational heritage, whatever that means in these days. I guess I'm of congregational heritage too, but I'm never quite sure what that means. It's good that we're all mixed up in so many different ways, and that we're all part of one church, the one church. And we're going to reflect that now in our final hymn, Christ is made the sure foundation, Christ the head and cornerstone. Full of surprises today. Would you take your seats for a moment? And I'm going to call on Lady Wallace to come and speak to us. Let us pray. Go in peace, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with each one of you both now and forevermore.
We welcome all of you in your homes, wherever you are, to our service here this morning in Grahamston United Church in Falkirk.
And now we will sing hymn 454, Son of God, Eternal Saviour, Source of Life and Truth and Grace.
Let us pray. Living God, loving Father, who sent us your Son as the suffering servant to bring us the healing of your love, we lift up before you the need of this world in which you have set us. Grant us all, good Lord, the humble, loving power of your Son, that we may learn from him to grow in loving service to your world. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. According to the holy institution and example of our Lord Jesus Christ, and for a memorial of him, we do this, who on the night he was betrayed took bread. And when he'd given thanks, he broke it and he said, "Take this and eat it. This is my body which is broken for you. Do this and remember me." In the same way, he took the cup after supper and said, "This cup is the new covenant sealed in my blood. Whenever you drink it, do it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Can I invite you to share that with those around you?
Grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with us all.